Would you please help me open today's session with a moment of silent meditation? And please allow me to offer a prayer. I will be concluding that prayer with the Serenity Prayer, at which time feel free to join me. God, thank you for allowing us to come together and pray in this way. And thank you for providing us a place that we can come together. We would like to thank you for those beautiful 12 steps in that book. And thank you for allowing each and every one of us for being sober during this day. And during this time together, we humbly ask for your care, your guidance, your wisdom, your direction, and your love as we walk through these steps. And God, we thank you for that air that you give us to breathe today. The food in our stomachs, the clothing on our backs, and the shelter over our heads. And God, please set aside everything that we think we know about ourselves, about the 12 steps, about the book, about sobriety, and about you, God. God, please help each and every one of us today to have an open mind so that we may have a new experience and discover the truth. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Thank you. I'm Paul Fisher, and I'm an alcoholic. And I'd like to welcome all of you to the third session of the Big Book Workshop, where we are taking the 12 steps as outlined in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous so that we may recover from our alcoholism. I'd like to welcome each and every one of you here today. I'd like to congratulate you on your willingness and your courage, those of you that completed your fourth step this week. We'll be talking about that in a moment. A couple of things to consider. I'm not here to challenge anyone. I'm not here to tell you how you should be doing sobriety. I'm not here to tell you how you should be living your life. I'm simply here to share with you my own personal experience and how I was taken through the steps in the beginning and how the steps were taken in the early 40s. So I'm going to be primarily continuing to stick to what it says in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous and sharing my own experience with you about that. If you have resistance to what's being shared in this workshop, I would ask you to consider having an open mind. If it's not in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous, it's not AA. When I work with other alcoholics, I only have a couple of things to share. One of those is my own experience in what it says in the Big Book. And that's it. That's all I really have to share, is my experience and what it says in the book. So let's see who's willing to be rocketed. Now, notice I said rocketed. I didn't say mosey or shuffle. We're going to be rocketed. In other words, it's going to be sudden. The authors mention that throughout the book. They talk about suddenly this happened, suddenly that happened. You know what suddenly means? It means without notice. That means my ego's not going to be knocking on the door and say, get ready, here we go. You're going to change. Your thinking is going to be transformed. Your ideas are going to be modified. So it happens suddenly. So, everybody who completed their fourth step, would you please stand? Okay, I'd like to congratulate each and every one of you. You are the ones that are going to be experiencing the promises that we'll be talking about today. You are the ones that are being rocketed into the fourth dimension. I'd like to welcome you to the Fellowship of the Spirit, and congratulations. Okay, now those of you that did not complete your fourth step, I would encourage you to continue coming to the workshop and continue going through the steps. And when you get opportunity to do so, go ahead and hook up with your sponsor, spiritual advisor, and do that fourth step. Because that's part of the path to the freedom that we all seek in these rooms. Also be aware, those of you that did not complete your fourth step, you will not be experiencing the promises that we're talking about today. You see, I cannot experience the promises that the authors talk about unless I'm willing to do exactly what the authors have done in this book. So if I want what they have, so when they talk about experiencing new freedom, new peace, new happiness, new sense of direction, I'm not going to experience those if I'm not willing to take the actions described in this book. Okay, so let's jump right into it. Assuming that you did your fourth and fifth step, we're going to turn to page 75. That's page 75. Paragraph 2. Page 75, paragraph 2. What we're going to be doing in the next few minutes is going over what we need to do after we complete our fifth step. In the event that your sponsor already walked you through this, I'm going to ask that you walk through it again with the rest of us in the workshop. For those of you that were not taken through the remaining steps in this way. Okay, paragraph 2. The authors say, we pocket our pride and go to it, illuminating every twist of character, every dark cranny of the past. Once we have taken this step, withholding nothing, we are delighted. We can look the world in the eye. We can be alone at perfect peace and ease. Our fears fall from us. We begin to feel the nearness of our Creator. We may have had certain spiritual beliefs, but now we begin to have a spiritual experience. The feeling that the drink problem has disappeared will often come strongly. We feel we are on the broad highway, walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe. These are the fifth step promises. As we mentioned in an earlier session, that there are not 12 promises in this book. There are many, many promises. These are the fifth step promises. Here's something to consider. The authors are saying, once I've taken this step, providing I withhold nothing, I'm going to be delighted. That doesn't mean I'm excited about what I'm sharing with you in my inventory, but am I delighted about the work I'm doing? Now, if I'm not delighted, I can shut the book and stop there. Because that's exactly what my first sponsor did with me. I did my first inventory. He said, are you delighted? And I said, no. And then he asked me a couple other questions. Do you feel that you can look the world in the eye? Well, no. Do I feel alone at perfect peace and ease? No. Are my fears falling from me? No. Did I begin to feel the nearness of my Creator? No. And he shut the book. He shut the book, said, that's it. I said, what do you mean that's it? We need to go on and do the other steps. He said, no. He says, it says right here, once we've taken the step withholding nothing, we are delighted. He said, you left something out. No, I didn't. Oh, yeah, you did. About 3 days later, I give him a call and I say, you know, there was this one thing. There was this one little thing that I forgot to mention. And invariably, that has been my experience with people I've taken through the steps. They get to this point, they're not delighted. It's because there's something they're still holding on to, because the authors are telling me, look how it's worded, withholding nothing, we are delighted. These are the promises of doing the fifth step. Now, my only experience with the inventory was this was the first, not first, but rather most impactful relationship, or rather most impactful experience I had with God. I began to have a much more impactful experience when I did my fourth step. Because for the first time in my life, I was able to sit down with another human being and tell them about all the stuff that I had done, all the harm I had caused to other people, all the secrets that I had concealed. These were all the things that were blocking me from God. So you see, when I'm willing to disclose that to another person, I am going to be delighted. And I started to experience what it says in the next sentence, that I could be alone in perfect peace and ease. So consider that. If you're not delighted about what you're doing, there's probably something you're leaving out. The last sentence, it says, we feel we're on the broad highway, walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe. How many times have you been to meetings and heard the topic, let me hear your experience with being with the spirit of the universe? I don't see any hands going up. It's right there in the book. They're telling us this is what we're going to experience. This isn't about knowledge. This isn't about information. This is something we're going to experience. I'm going to begin experiencing walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe. What's that like for you? See, if I don't have that experience, I can't transmit it. And if I haven't experienced it, I certainly can't talk about it. So if you're having an experience of walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe, I encourage you to take that experience back to your meetings and tell people about it. Share your experience about walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe. Now, I would have resistance when I would hear people talking about these things in meetings. And the reason I had resistance to it is because I was not having that experience. So if you share an experience that I haven't had, my mind is going to have resistance to it. Oh, that's not possible. He's not really walking hand in hand with the spirit of the universe. He's just like the rest of us. He's a drunk just like me. Well, of course. But I'm here to tell you, when we take these steps in the way that they were done in the 40s, your sobriety is going to look really different, because that's what happened to me. My sponsor took me through the steps very quickly. See, you cannot take anybody through these steps too quickly. But I'll tell you what, you can take them through too slowly. See, I'm the real alcoholic. I need to get through these steps as quickly as possible, because I need to get to that power, and I need to get to it now. Because I need power, because I'm a real alcoholic. So, consequently, people I got sober with, some of them didn't get around to doing their four steps until they were 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 months. I wasn't superior to those people. All I'm saying is that my sobriety looked really different. I felt really different than they did. They struggled much longer than I did. Because when I went all the way through the steps, I had that spiritual awakening. The compulsion to drink was removed. Okay, next paragraph. Here the authors are giving us specific instructions on what to do when we finish our fifth step. Returning home. You notice after we do this, it doesn't say, you know, take a week or two to consider what you did. It doesn't say go to a movie. You know, it doesn't say go take a bubble bath and relax. You've done a good job. No, it says returning home. In other words, I've just finished my fifth step. Returning home, we find a place where we can be quiet for an hour, carefully reviewing what we have done. Carefully reviewing. That's why we don't burn our fourth step. I can't tell you how many times I've heard that in meetings. Yeah, I got done my fourth step. My sponsor said, go ahead and burn it. Why? I need that inventory for future reference. Then they ask us to say a prayer. It says, we thank God from the bottom of our heart that we know Him better. So if I'm going to thank God, that means I'm going to say a prayer. So I'm going to carefully review what I've already done. Then I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to thank God from the bottom of my heart that I know him better. Taking this book down from our shelf, we turn to the page which contains the 12 steps. That means I'm going to flip back to page 59. Carefully reading, doesn't say read, carefully reading the first five proposals, we ask, if I'm going to ask, that's a prayer. We ask if we have omitted anything, for we are building an arch through which we shall walk a free man at last. So you see, if I'm going to be free, if I want that freedom, these are the instructions that are necessary for me to follow. In other words, I'm going to turn back to page 59, and I'm going to take the first five steps, and I'm going to take them and turn them into questions. Have I admitted that I have no power over alcohol? Have I admitted that my life is unmanageable? In other words, I need a new manager. And then I'm going to review step two. Have I come to believe that a power greater than me can restore me to sanity? And then I'm going to go to step three. I'm going to ask that question. Have I made that decision to turn my will, my life over to the care of God as I understand him? Step four, have I made a searching and fearless moral inventory? Step five, have I admitted to myself, to God, and another person the exact nature of my wrongs? And then they're going to ask us to consider further questions. I was taught that wherever there's this question mark in the book, it's like a stop sign. I'm going to stop, and I'm going to ask that question. Is our work solid so far? So stop and ask yourself that. Is your work solid so far? Are the stones properly in place? Have you skimped on the cement put into the foundation? Have we tried to make mortar without sand? These are the things we will consider in this hour. Then we turn the page. Then the authors say, if, big word, if we can answer to our satisfaction, we then look at step six. We have emphasized willingness as being indispensable. Do you know what indispensable means? It means I can't live without it. In other words, my willingness is indispensable. Here comes a question. Are we now ready to let God remove from us all the things which we have admitted are objectionable? That which is objectionable is that which blocks me from God. When I'm blocked from God, I'm blocked from you. So let's ask that question of ourselves. Are you now ready to let God? See, I have to be willing to let God remove them. So if there's something that I want you to take, let's say I have this bottle of water up here. Let's say I want you to take this bottle of water, and I bring it to you, and I hand it to you, and you grab a hold of it, but I don't let go. You could be stronger than me. You could be more powerful than me. You could be bigger than me. But if I'm not willing to let go of that bottle, you can't remove it. So you see, step six is about getting ready. The sixth step is preparing us to ask God to remove it. So that's all we're doing in step six, is getting ready. Then another question. Can he now take them all, every one? Ask that question. Can he take them all? If we still cling to something, we will not let go. We ask God to help us be willing. There's a prayer. If you have some resistance, we ask God. The authors even give us a clue that step six is about getting ready. In the very next paragraph, they say, when ready. So I have to make sure I'm ready. Okay, so am I ready? Okay, let's move on to step seven. When ready, we say something like this. My Creator, I am now willing that you should have all of me. Good and bad. Not some of me, not the worst parts, not the majority of me, but all of me, good and bad. I pray that you now remove from me every single defect of character which stands in the way of my usefulness to you and my fellows. Grant me strength as I go out from here to do your bidding. Amen. We have then completed step seven. This is the reason we need to be specific about what we're asking God to remove. My own experience is that if I'm not specific, and I don't know literally what it is I'm asking him to remove, he can't remove it. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that he will remove it, because I'm not God. I don't know when he's going to remove it. My job is just simply to identify specifically what I want him to remove. You notice that my name isn't anywhere in these two paragraphs? It's not in there, is it? So you see, I'm not working on my defects. You ever heard that? Yes, I'm working on my defects of character. Certainly. If you hear me saying I'm working on my defects, really what I'm saying is I'm going to embellish them. The more I work on my defects, the worse they get. That doesn't mean I don't make a conscious effort to be honest, sincere, helpful, willing, thoughtful. Sure, go ahead and make an effort in those areas. You see, these steps are paradoxical. I don't remove the defects. I simply do the work and leave the results to the God of my understanding. So you see, it's impossible for me to work on my defects if I'm applying these spiritual principles. Okay, let's see who's ready to do 6 and 7. And what I'm going to ask is that we read the 7-step prayer out loud together. So those of you that are willing to do so, and you feel that you are ready to let God remove all these things that have blocked you from him, let's go ahead and say the 7-step prayer together. My Creator, I am now willing that you should have all of me, good and bad. I pray that you now remove from me every single defect of character which stands in the way of my usefulness to you and my fellows. Grant me strength as I go out from here to do your bidding. Amen. Congratulations. Okay, now that we've completed step 7, let's move on to steps 8 and 9. Let's turn back to page 59. Let's read those steps. Page 59. Let's go down to step 8. Where it says, made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. Step 9, made direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. Okay, back here on page 76, paragraph 3, back here on page 76, paragraph 3, notice what the authors immediately say after we've taken the 7-step. They say, now we need more action, without which we find that faith without works is dead. Let's look at steps 8 and 9. We have a list of all persons we have harmed and to whom we are willing to make amends. We made it when we took inventory. Wow. Do you see what they're saying? If you haven't burned your 4-step, you already have your amends list completed. It says it right there. It says we have a list. It doesn't say we construct or develop a list. It says we have a list. So you see, if I'm doing the inventory as outlined in this book, I already have a list. It says we made it when we took inventory. It's already there. They go on to say, we subjected ourselves to a drastic self-appraisal. Now we go out to our fellows and repair the damage done in the past. We attempt to sweep away the debris which has accumulated out of our effort to live on self-will and run the show ourselves. If we haven't the will to do this, we ask until it comes. Remember, it was agreed at the beginning we would go to any lengths for victory over alcohol. So if I'm going to go out and repair means to mend or restore. To mend or restore. In other words, I'm going to attempt to mend or restore the damage that I have caused. Okay, page 77. Third line from the top of the page. Page 77, third line from the top of the page. Our real purpose is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. Here the authors are telling me what my real purpose in life is. Not my purpose in AA, but my purpose in life. It doesn't say to be of maximum service. It says to fit ourselves to be of maximum service. In other words, I have purpose and meaning for life today. I didn't have that when I first came into Alcoholics Anonymous. I had no sense of purpose. I had no sense of meaning for life. Life didn't have any meaning. I thought it was over. Now I have purpose. Wow. From that line, let's go down 7 lines. Go down 7 lines from where we just read. But our man is sure to be impressed with a sincere desire to set right the wrong. That means I'm going to attempt to right the wrong. In order to do that, it's going to be necessary for me to ask, what can I do to right the wrong? Because that's why I'm there. Let's go to the next paragraph. Next paragraph, line 4. Next paragraph, line 4. The question of how to approach the man we hated will arise. It may be he has done us more harm than we have done him. And though we may have acquired a better attitude toward him, we are still not too keen about admitting our faults. Nevertheless, with a person we dislike, we take the bit in our teeth. It is harder to go to an enemy than to a friend, but we find it much more beneficial to us. We go to him in a helpful and forgiving spirit, confessing our former ill feeling and expressing our regret. The experience that comes to mind is the word arrogance kept coming up in my inventories, and I finally faced the reality that in order to be free from that, it was necessary for me to go back and make amends to every single person I knew in AA that had been affected by my arrogance. And I did not want to do that. I still don't like making amends. I make them because I want to be free. So I hemmed and hawed, and there was this one person in AA who I felt didn't really deserve my amends because he was much more arrogant than me. So I went ahead and humbled myself, and then I went to the guy and admitted I was wrong in treating him the way that I had and that my arrogance had caused him harm. And when I got to the part of the amends where I asked, is there anything I can do to right this with you? And he responded with, nah, watching you grovel was enough for me. You see, but by that time, I ended up laughing right along with him. You see, it's important for us to not take ourselves too seriously. And I'll tell you why it's essential that we not take ourselves too serious. And that's because we are the joke. I'm the joke. You won't have that experience if you don't do these steps. Okay. Last paragraph on page 77. Last paragraph on page 77. Under no condition do we criticize such a person or argue. Simply we tell him that we will never get over drinking until we have done our utmost to straighten out the past. We are there to sweep off our side of the street, realizing that nothing worthwhile can be accomplished until we do so, never trying to tell him what he should do. His faults are not discussed. We stick to our own. If our manner is calm, frank, and open, we will be gratified with the result. I'm not there to talk about them. I'm not there to talk about their wrongs. When I go out to make an amend, I'm there to do one thing and one thing only, and that is to make an amend. So if you're going to make an amend, and then when you get done, you think, okay, now there's something I need to share with you. Okay, now I got the amend out of the way, and I share that with you. And then I turn to the person and say, oh, by the way, there's some feelings I need to share with you. Or I need to confront you about some behavior of yours. I can guarantee you it will dilute the amend. Because that's not what it says here. See, I'm there to sweep off my side of the street. You see, it doesn't matter how people respond. It does not matter whether they accept or reject the amend. I'm there for one reason only, to clean up my side of the street so I can be clean and I can be right with my God and I can be right with you. So you see, it doesn't matter if you reject my amend. It does not matter. That's not why I'm there. I'm not doing it there to please you, to maintain your friendship, to get you to like me, to give me some strokes, pat me on the back. I can tell you what will happen when our motives aren't clear. My wife did something to me one day, and I resented it. And I felt she owed me an amend. And I instantly recognized that I needed to make her an amend as well. So I decided, well, if I go make an amend to her, she'll make one to me, right? So I go to her and I make this poetic amend. And I go to her and I make this amend, and she doesn't say anything. So then I walk off, pissed off. I mean, I humbled myself. What kind of a program is she working? She didn't make amends to me. And then it hit me that my motives were dishonest. Oh, my God, now I got to go back and make amends for the way I made amends. Now, keep in mind, at this time, I had no expectations of amends from her because I was clear about the motives for making that amends. So I went back to her and made amends for the way I made amends. And since I got done, she says, oh, yeah, by the way, I have an amend I'd like to make to you. Page 78, paragraph 2. Page 78, paragraph 2. Most alcoholics owe money. We do not dodge our creditors. Telling them what we are trying to do, we make no bones about our drinking. They usually know it anyway, whether we think so or not. Nor are we afraid of disclosing our alcoholism on the theory it may cause financial harm. Approached in this way, the most ruthless creditor will sometimes surprise us. Arranging the best deal we can, we let these people know we are sorry. Our drinking has made us slow to pay. We must lose our fear of creditors, no matter how far we have to go. For we are liable to drink if we are afraid to face them. So here the authors are telling us, it's okay to let the person know that you're a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous, that you've been slow to pay. An experience that comes to mind is I committed an armed robbery when I was drinking. And there were two of us involved in it. Now, the question is, am I entitled to go back to that Taco Bell and tell them my crime partner's name? Not according to what the authors instruct. So I was asked that inevitable question by my sponsor. How free do you want to be? I don't know if I want to be that free. What happened was I had the money in hand and I went back to the Taco Bell. And I walked in, and of course, the management had changed. And I walked in and I let them know who I was. Hi. My name is Paul Fisher. I'm a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous. And in order for me to stay sober, it's essential that I go back and I correct all the wrongs that I've committed. By the way, I didn't mention my crime partner's name because the truth was I did commit the crime. I robbed your store and I believe this is the amount of money that I took. And I handed him the money. His first reaction was, you know, I could call the police. I said, I'm aware of that. He said, I don't believe you're doing this. Why are you here? So I reiterated one more time. I'm a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous. And in order for me to stay sober, it's essential that I right all the wrongs that I've committed. Otherwise, I won't stay sober. He said, I just can't believe. I've never heard of such a thing. Do all you people do this? I wasn't going to answer that question. Because I'm a spokesman for AA. Anywhere I go, I'm a spokesman for AA. I asked him if there was anything else I could do. He said, no, this is fine. This is great. And I'm a free man today. See, that doesn't hang over my head anymore. Okay, page 79. Page 79, paragraph 1. Page 79, paragraph 1. Although these reparations take innumerable forms, there are some general principles which we find guiding, reminding ourselves that we have decided to go to any lengths to find a spiritual experience. We ask that we be given strength and direction to do the right thing, no matter what the personal consequences may be. We may lose our position or reputation or face jail, but we are willing. We have to be. We must not shrink at anything. Notice that the authors say that these take innumerable forms. There are a lot of creative ways we can make amends. Working with a sponsor who has experience in going through these steps repeatedly, who has experience with making amends, sponsors can be very creative. There was a group of people that I owed money to in another state, and it was a large four-figure amount of money. So what I did was I wrote a letter, general service delivery, in that town, hoping to contact these people because I didn't know how to find them. And I didn't get a response, so I felt, well, I'm done with that one. You know, if the opportunity presents itself, I'll make that amend. And I took that back to my sponsor, and he said, well, let's hold on a minute. And then he asked that question. He said, how free do you want to be? I hate it. Whenever he starts any conversation with, how free do you want to be? I knew something is in store that I'm not going to like. It's not going to suit my ego. So he asked the question. I said, yeah, I'm willing to go to any length. He said, by the way, when you took that money, do those people belong to the same universe that you do? I said, yeah. He said, so not only did you take money from those people, you took money from our universe, didn't you? I said, yeah. I said, well, you willing to pay it back? And I said, yeah. He said, okay, this is what we're going to do. He said, every time you go to a meeting and the seventh tradition basket comes around, you're going to put at least a $10 or $20 bill in there. And you're not allowed to let anybody see you do it, and you're not allowed to tell anyone. I'll tell you, man, that was really hard. Because that basket came around, I wanted to snap that $20 bill, and I wanted everybody to know what a generous little AA I was being. Can you see how generous I am? Look here, I'm putting a $20 bill in there. I'm so big-hearted. And it was difficult. So what I did was I maintained a written record of the amount of money until it was paid off. He instructed me not to tell anybody for 5 years. So for the first 5 years of sobriety, I couldn't tell a soul about that. So you see, sponsors can be very creative. A couple of other examples. I sponsor a guy who committed cruelty to animals. What he did is he went to an animal shelter and did some volunteer work. Another guy was cruel to women. He ended up going back to a women's shelter and doing some volunteer work. Just recently, I sponsor a guy, and I had him go to a woman that I selected and to sit down with her because this person had committed harm to a number of nameless women. He didn't know their names. So I had him sit down with this woman and make the amends to her. So you see, there are a lot of creative ways that we can make amends. Okay, page 79, paragraph 2. Page 79, paragraph 2. Usually, however, other people are involved. Therefore, we are not to be the hasty and foolish martyr who would needlessly sacrifice others to save himself from the alcoholic pit. In other words, we need to be considerate of who may be affected by this. That's why in step 9 it says, make direct amends wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. So I need to consider that. Is this amend going to cause more harm? If so, I do not make that amend directly to that person. In other words, I'm not allowed to go back and make amends to someone at their expense just so I can relieve myself of my own guilt and shame. Okay, page 80. Page 80, paragraph 1. Page 80, paragraph 1. Before taking drastic action, which might implicate other people, we secure their consent. If we have obtained permission, these are the instructions, if we have obtained permission, have consulted with others, ask God to help, and the drastic step is indicated, we must not shrink. So I need to consider, are other people going to be affected? For example, I'm married. I need to make a financial amend. There's an ideal payment arrangement in my head. I need to sit down with my wife and go over it with her. You know, there's a financial amend I need to make. How's that going to affect our budget? So you see, I wasn't entitled to mention my crime partner's name when I made that amend, because I'm not there to satisfy myself at the expense of someone else. So here the authors are giving us specific instructions. We've obtained permission. We've consulted with others. In other words, I'm not out there running on my own doing this. In other words, I'm going to check it out with my sponsor. Okay. Paragraph 4 on page 80. Paragraph 4. Line 4. Page 80, paragraph 4, line 4. He saw that he had to place the outcome in God's hands or he would soon start drinking again. See, I'm there to do God's work. This is part of God's work. When I made that decision in step 3, to turn my will and life over to the care of God, as I understand it, simply means I'm going to do God's work. What does that mean? That means I'm going to go out and clear up the wreckage of my past and present, if you have any, so I can be free, so I can be of service to other people. And I'm going to place the outcome in God's hands. I didn't know what was going to happen when I went back to that Taco Bell. I didn't know. I didn't know what was going to happen as a result of putting that money in the basket. All I know is it was necessary for me to place the outcome in God's hands. There was another amend I made years after the fact where I owed a music store a bunch of money for some equipment that I had bought on the installment plan, which I'd never paid for. Now, at the time I committed the harm, they didn't have computers. I called the music store, identified myself. Hi, my name's Paul Fisher. I'm a sober member of AA, blah, 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 blah. And the guy asked, well, when was this? And I gave him the estimated year. He said, hold on a minute. He put me in hold for 15, 20 minutes. He came back and he said, we can't find any record. I said, are you sure? I said, I'm certain that I owe you this money. So he put me on hold again for 10 more minutes. Come to find out, he ended up going up to the attic, and they had these little index cards where they maintained their records for the money that people owed them. And he came back on the phone the second time. He said, I don't believe you're making this call. Why are you doing this? Nobody has ever done this. Why are you doing this? I reiterated to him, I'm a sober alcoholic today in AA, and if I don't make this amend, I'm not going to stay sober. And then he asked me, well, how much money would you like? Well, how do you want to handle it? I said, well, I can afford to send you X amount of dollars a month. Would that be, that'll be fine with us. That'll be great. It happened as a result of going to them in a humble and forgiving spirit, as the authors have instructed us to do in this chapter. Not one time in the entire time I've been sober have I heard an unreasonable request, providing that my motives were clear and pure and that I approached them in a humble, forgiving spirit. Okay. Let's turn to page 82. Page 82, paragraph 2. Page 82, paragraph 2. Line 2. Second line in that paragraph. Sometimes we hear an alcoholic say that the only thing he needs to do is keep sober. Certainly he must keep sober, for there will be no home if he doesn't. But he is yet a long way from making good to the wife or parents whom for years he has so shockingly treated. Without an exception, every single person I have known in the rooms of AA who have gotten sober and who have drank again, and I've known people who have come into these rooms, went through the steps, pray every day, work with newcomers, go down to LARC, do H&I work, etc., etc., and they drink again. And without exception, they all have one thing in common, and it has nothing to do with they stop going to meetings. Because I've seen a lot of people through the years drink again who go to meetings on a regular basis. What they had in common was they did not finish their amends. See, an ironic thing happens to me in these rooms. I start to develop a thing called a conscience. My threshold for pain today is lower than it was when I was new. What I mean by that is I can't tolerate the guilt and the shame, the regret with dishonesty today like I used to be able to. I can't get away with the things that I couldn't get away with before, and today it's even worse. So I've developed a conscience. Now, if I'm a real alcoholic and I'm engaged in dishonest conduct and I haven't completed all my amends, I'm probably going to drink again. Why? Because I'm a real alcoholic. I can only stand the pain for so long. I'm going to have to medicate it. Top of page 83. Paragraph 1, page 83. Yes, there is a long period of reconstruction ahead. We must take the lead. Notice it doesn't say we kick back and wait for the person to come to us. We take the lead. So if there's somebody that you've committed a harm towards here in the valley, make contact. You take the lead. That's what I must do. I must take the lead. I've heard many times, well, I think I'll just make that amend on the phone. My question is, did you commit the harm over the phone? Did you commit the harm in person? That may mean I may need to get on that plane and go back to Philadelphia, to Chicago, to L.A., to make that amend. Earlier in this chapter, we heard about gaining consent. And that's what I was taught to do. So when I need to make an amend, and I see you at the meeting, I'm not going to go up to you and say, come here, come here, come here, I have an amend I need to make. No, I'm going to gain your consent. That means I'm going to go to you, and I'm going to let you know. There's an amend I'd like to make. Are you open to hearing it? The person may say no. I've had that experience. I've heard the person say, no, I'm not open to hearing it. Does that mean I need to go back and make the amend at a later time? No, because I made the effort, providing that I feel genuinely sorry for what I've done. So I'm going to ask for their consent. Then I'm going to ask them, if they say yes, they're open to hearing it, I'm going to ask them one of three questions. If I'm speaking to the person on the phone, because that's the only way I can reach them, I'm going to leave a message. And this is what I did on this one particular incident. I called the person up, and I had wounded this woman deeply, not once, but several times. I had betrayed her. So I sensed that she probably wasn't too willing to hear from me anytime soon. So what I did was I waited for the dust to settle. That's why it's important to have a sponsor who's had experience with making these amends. There are times that we can go back and make amends prematurely, too soon. That's why I need spiritual guidance. So what I did was I left a message on her voicemail. I let her know what I was about to do. I had an amend I'd like to make. I'd like to know if she was open to it. And then I asked her these three questions. Would you rather hear it over the phone? Would you like to receive it in writing? Or would you prefer to meet in person? She called back, left a message on my voicemail, thanked me for the amend, thanked me for the growth that I was experiencing, and said I would prefer to receive it in writing. And that's what I did, and it's a done deal. So keep that in mind. We're there to gain consent first. We're not there to demand anything. Page 83, paragraph 2. Page 83, paragraph 2. The spiritual life is not a theory. We have to live it. I'm living this program. I'm not doing it. I'm not working the steps anymore. Consider living the steps in your life rather than trying to work them. Next paragraph on the same page. There may be some wrongs we can never fully right. We don't worry about them if we can honestly say to ourselves that we would right them if we could. Some people cannot be seen. We send them an honest letter, and there may be a valid reason for postponement in some cases. But we don't delay if it can be avoided. We should be sensible, tactful, considerate, and humble without being servile or scraping. As God's people, we stand on our feet. We don't crawl before anyone. There are some people we can't contact. What I do is I have this little file at home with a little card in there with the person's name and the harm. And in the event that that person presents themselves, then I'm willing to make that amend. Next paragraph. These are the ninth step promises. These are not the 12 promises. Some alcoholic came up with that idea. If we are painstaking about this phase of our development, what phase? The phase of making amends. Check this out. We will be amazed before we're halfway through. So we're going to be amazed before we are halfway through making our amends. They're not saying before we're halfway through the steps. In other words, I'm not going to experience these promises when I'm at step 6. Look at where this paragraph is. It's contained within the 9th step of the book. And here are the promises. This is what you will experience before you're halfway through, if you're willing to go to any length to be free from alcoholism. We are going to know a new freedom and a new happiness. Wow. New freedom. Freedom like you've never experienced before. Happiness, not happiness, new happiness. We will not regret the past nor wish to shut the door on it. We will comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace. No matter how far down the scale we have gone, we will see how our experience can benefit others. That feeling of uselessness and self-pity will disappear. We will lose interest in selfish things and gain interest in our fellows. Self-seeking will slip away. Our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. Fear of people and of economic insecurity will leave us. We will intuitively know how to handle situations which used to baffle us. We will suddenly realize that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. Are these extravagant promises? We think not. They are being fulfilled among us, sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly. They will always materialize if we work for them. So in order for me to experience these promises, I have to be willing to take the action. The guys that I sponsor absolutely amaze me. Absolutely amaze me. That is one of the gifts in having gone through the steps and sponsoring other people and watching the gift of sobriety and God's grace and the freedom when we take these actions. The experience that comes to mind is that I sponsor a guy who has harmed black people. So I meet him in a coffee shop and we're going over his 9-step list. And there happens to be a black guy sitting in the restaurant. And I ask the guy, "Are you willing to go to any length to have a spiritual experience?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "Come on, let's go." I said, "Where are we going?" So we go over and we sit down with this black gentleman. We introduce ourselves. We explain to him what this person is about to do. The guy's sitting there with his elderly grandmother. We sit down. And the guy goes through the spiel, you know. He identifies his name. Lets him know that he's a sober member of AA and that he's harmed a lot of black people through the years. And then he says, "I was wrong," and that he was truly sorry. And then he asks, "What can I do to right this?" In the meantime, his grandmother has a smile from ear to ear. So here are four people having a spiritual experience. Not one, but all four of us. He got to the part of the end where he asked, "What can I do to right this?" And the guy responded with, "Well, God has already forgiven you, and I've forgiven you." What a wonderful experience. Chances are that that gentleman never heard an amen from a white guy before in that manner. It was a healing experience. And he walked away a free man. And I walked away a free man. And I walked away with some gratitude, and my cup was full because I got to sit and witness the miracle of making amends. And I'm here to tell you from personal experience, you will have those kinds of experiences if you're willing to go to any length. The question is, how free do you want to be? I'd like to show you how not to make an amend and show you how to properly make an amend. First, I'd like to share with you, as instructed in the book, these are the things we are going to say when we make amends. The thing I love about this chapter is that the authors tell us what to say, what not to say, when to do it, when not to do it. So you see, when I make amends, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to gain consent. I'm going to ask the person if they're open to hearing it. Depending on the circumstances, I will ask how they would like to hear it, in person, on the phone, in writing. If it's right there in person, I'm going to ask if they're open to hearing it now. The first thing I'm going to share with them is the wrong, what I did. Then I'm going to say, I was wrong. It's okay to say, I'm sorry. It's not okay for me to simply say, I'm sorry. An apology is not an amend. An amend is an attempt to right the wrong. That means I'm going to ask a question. And the question is there anything I can do to right this with you? Okay, now I'm going to show you how not to make an amend. Let's say my friend Jeffrey here. Let's say I called him a name. Let's say I called him an asshole. I know some of you may have a different perspective on this one, but okay, here's how not to make it. Hey, Jeff, come here. I got an amend I need to make to you. Hey, I'm really sorry the other day I called you an asshole, but you know I was having a really difficult time, you know, at this time in my life. You know, I'm in therapy right now, and I'm working on my family of origin, and all these mother issues and all these father issues are coming up, you know, and I just wasn't myself. You know, I didn't get enough sleep the other night because I had to work really late, you know, and I had to take my cat to the veterinarian, you know, and man, I was really upset about that. And, you know, I'm just really sorry for doing that. Couple things, couple guidelines to consider. Number one, we do not offer reasons for our conduct. We do not offer explanations or excuses for it. We do not share our feelings. That is not the purpose of making amends. Here is the proper way of making an amend. Jeffrey, I have an amend I'd like to make to you. Are you open to hearing it? The other day I called you an asshole, and I'm truly sorry. I was wrong for doing that. You don't deserve to be talked to in that way, and I'd like to know if there's anything I can do to right that with you.
Just don't do it again.
I'm willing to do that. So he says, please don't do it again. That means I have to be willing to follow through. Once again, not one time in the entire 20 years I've been sober have I heard an unreasonable request when I followed the outline as instructed in this book. When I make that amend, I'm not going to shift into another dialogue with him and say something like, by the way, I have some feelings that I need to share with you about what you said to me the other night. No, if I have something like that to deal with, I'm going to do it at another time, but I'm not going to do it then. This is what I like to call the freedom step, because that's what step 9 does. It frees me up. It frees me up to be able to walk down the street with my head up high, with some dignity and some integrity, because I'm free. These things can no longer block me from God. Now, the thing I've discovered about amends is that I don't like making them. I still do not like making them. You don't have to like it. That's why I'm a lot more careful today when I speak to people. Not because I'm a nice guy, because I don't want to make amends later. Now, this is what I was taught to do. You can take it or leave it. What I do is I go out and I get myself some 3x5 index cards. Or you can get a small pocket tablet like this one. I go back to my inventory, and each person gets one card. So if I've harmed John three different ways, John doesn't get three cards. John gets one card. I put the person's name on it, and then I list the harm, specifically listing the harm. My amends work is no longer guesswork. I don't have to sit there and try to remember. Let's see, did I make that amend? Do I owe that person an amend? See, it's all in writing. I make that amend, I throw that card away. I'm done with that amend. Another thing I like to do after doing my inventory is I like to sit down and go through my Rolodex at home or my address book. Because I will find that I have harmed people along the way that did not show up in my inventory and add them to the list. Why do I do this? Because I want to be free. I don't want to be blocked anymore. See, if I'm blocked, I'm not going to stay sober. That's the bottom line. If I'm blocked, I'm not going to stay sober. If I'm blocked, I'm not going to stay spiritually fit, and I'm not going to be able to be of maximum service to God in you. That's the reason I continue making amends. So, what I'm encouraging you to do this week is to start making your amends. Remember, we don't have to make all the amends at one time. We don't wait until we're done with all our amends and then move on to step 10. We start making our amends, we immediately move into step 10. Next week, we'll be covering steps 10, 11, and 12. What I'd like to do with the time remaining today is to set the groundwork for doing the 11th step exercise. You have three handouts. The first one is called the AA 4 Standards in the Oxford Group for Absolutes. Go ahead and pull that one out. Keep in mind that a good portion of what we have in our big book and the principles that we have today were taken from the Oxford group, which the early AA members participated. That's where AA got its start. Got its start was in the Oxford group, and then eventually the AA members left the Oxford group and started their own organization, later to be known as Alcoholics Anonymous. And this is what they discovered. See, in the big book, we have what are called the four standards. At the bottom of the page, these are listed on page 67 and page 84. The opposite of those are called the four absolutes, which the early AA members obtained from the Oxford group. They are honesty, purity, unselfish, and love. In other words, the opposite of selfish is unselfish. The opposite of dishonesty is honesty. The opposite of resentment is purity, and the opposite of fear is love. Now, the guidance I receive in meditation that is selfish, dishonest, resentful, or fearful is clearly guidance that came from me. Guidance that I receive in meditation, which is unselfish, honest, pure, and loving, I can be assured came from God. And I'm going to walk you through a process that they use early on in AA. First, I'd like to talk just briefly about meditation. We will talk more about this next week. Keep in mind what the authors are saying in step 11. Step 11 does not say, sought through prayer to improve our conscious contact. It says, sought through prayer and meditation. Consider that meditation is simply listening. The thing I've discovered about meditation is that you cannot do it wrong and you do not need to do it right. What works for one person may not work for another. You need to find a way that works for you. What's most important is that you're willing to try it and that you're willing to attempt listening. So here's what prayer without meditation is like. Let's say my friend Rusty here calls me up and invites me to a party to his house. I said, great, I'll be right over. Now hang up before I get directions on how to get there. I'm not going to know which way to go. That's what prayer without meditation is like. I've had that experience in these rooms, not meditating and only praying. Now, my understanding of a relationship is that it involves two-way communication. That means there's talking and there's listening. So if there's talking and no listening, is that a relationship? No. So you see, I can't really have a relationship with God if all I'm doing is praying. I did that. Yeah, I'll just thank God in the morning, you know, or ask Him to keep me sober at night, thanking for keeping me sober. That's not a relationship. In order for me to have a relationship with my friend Diane here, it's necessary that I talk and then I listen. That's called two-way communication. So you see, if I'm not practicing meditation in addition to the prayer, a couple of things are not going to happen. Number one, I'm not going to improve my relationship, nor am I going to receive the knowledge of His will, nor am I going to receive the power to carry it out. So see, if all I'm doing is praying, I'm still operating on self-will. I make it sound like I'm living a spiritual way of life, but I'm really not. Okay, there's one called meditation. Please pull out that handout. The top of it is entitled Meditation. Meditation. If I am not receiving thoughts when I listen, the fault is not God's. Usually it is because there is something I will not do. These are typically some of the reasons we are blocked during meditation and we're not hearing guidance. Keep in mind that guidance can come in the form of an intuitive thought. Here's one. Something wrong in my life that I will not face and make right. Maybe there's something I'm not willing to face. A habit or indulgence I will not give up. Now, I'm not giving that thing up. It may block me. A person I will not forget. Oh, I can't forgive them. Look what they did to me. They caused me more harm than I caused them. Guaranteed to block you. A wrong relationship in my life I will not give up. Yeah, but it's my responsibility to take care of that daughter or that son of mine. To an extent. I can't leave her. I love her too much. Can't leave him. I love him too. He needs me. A restitution I will not make. I'm not paying that money back. I don't need to. Something God has already told me to do that I will not obey. Here's a common experience I've had numerous times. I take something to meditation, and I don't like the guidance I receive. So I do one of two things. I go out and I do some poll taking. And I start asking for other people's feedback. Along the way, I'm eventually going to find somebody to endorse what I want to do. The other response I have is, I think I need to meditate on that some more. I've already received the guidance. I just don't want to do it. For example, on this, a restitution I will not make. I refuse to make that restitution, and I justify why I'm not making that amend. For example, I remember in early sobriety, there was this stereo I wanted to buy. I needed to buy this kick-ass stereo for my apartment. And I had not made some major financial amends. And that's when my sponsor pointed out to me, is that your money you're spending? Oh, yeah, that's my money. I earned it. Really? Don't you owe those people X amount of dollars? Well, yeah. Then you know whose money you're spending? Theirs? Yes, I was spending their money. It was their money, not mine. It took a while for that one to register. Okay, these are some of the things that can block you in meditation. Okay, basically this is what the early AA members did. Be aware that in the 40s, the early AA members, especially in the Cleveland and Akron area, did what they called daily written meditation. They did it daily. They prayed and they meditated. After meditating, they pulled out pencil and paper and wrote down all the guidance that they received. No editing. Write it all down. And then they took those thoughts, that guidance, and they tested it against the four absolutes. See, if it's honest, pure, loving, and unselfish, I can be assured that it came from God, keeping in mind that not everything I hear in meditation comes from God. So what this process will do for you is it will clearly identify the origin of your guidance. So they would take the four absolutes and test it against the guidance. This way they could be assured which guidance came from God and which came from them. Here are some examples on this piece of paper, on this handout. Let's assume that this is the guidance you received in your meditation. Give them a piece of my mind. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? No, that came from me. Next one, be patient with others today. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? Yes, that came from God. I need to avoid that person today. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? No. Be kind to others today. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? Yes, that came from God. Accept others as they are. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? Yes. So here we can be assured which guidance came from me and which came from God. This is what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to do it just for 1 week. Try it for 1 week. Meditate after you pray. That means listen. All the guidance that comes to you, write it down on paper. Test the guidance against the four absolutes. Come back next week. And though I understand this is a private matter, personal to you in your two-way communication with God, I'm going to ask that you come back next week and be willing to share with us the guidance that you received from God, not the guidance you received from you. So what you do is you test it against the four absolutes, cross off the guidance that came from you. The purpose of doing this is to show you that God does exist and that he does communicate to us during meditation. Those of you that are willing to complete this exercise will be a great example to those in this room that are still doubtful that God communicates to us through meditation. There are a lot of books out there that you can read on meditation. There's one book I would recommend that you get for meditation, and it's a book that has the word meditation in it. If it says meditation, get it. If you don't have information on meditation, it's information that you don't have. There's no right way, there's no wrong way to do this. You have to find a way that works for you. What I did in the beginning was I used the Serenity Prayer for a period of time. I used the 12 steps. In other words, I would recite all 12 steps in my head so I could get quiet. You can try using breathing exercises or simply focusing on your breathing. Go through a process where you're relaxing the entire body, you know, where you're starting at the top of your head and you're telling yourself, okay, I'm going to relax my head, my neck, my shoulders, my chest, my stomach, et cetera, et cetera. Whatever works for you. Personally, I like to have a quiet place. When I do my meditation, I go a place where there's no phones and there's no TV and there's no one knocking on the door. And I go through my prayers and I go through this process of attempting to become quiet and still. In the beginning, it was real difficult. There was a lot of chatter going on in my head. The worst thing we can do during meditation is trying to stop it. Let it happen. Don't try to control the chatter in your head. A couple things I'm asking you to do this week. Begin making your amends. Practice the daily written meditation. Next week, we'll be covering steps 10, 11, 12. And I would recommend that you read starting with the second paragraph on page 84 up to page 103. That's the second paragraph on page 84 up to page 103 in preparation for next week. I'd like to congratulate all of you. I'd like to welcome you to the Fellowship of the Spirit and welcome you to being rocketed into the fourth dimension. Thank you for letting me be of service. And would you please help me close with the Lord's Prayer?